Alright, so we've been looking at the subspace constraint problem, and we've been looking at ways of defining the affinity for the subspace clustering problem. And we arrived at this idea of expressing data points as linear combinations of each other. And we discussed the fact that the linear combinations are generally not unique. And therefore, we discussed the idea that among all possible linear combinations, I'm going to search for linear combinations that are low rank. We formulated the problem as minimizing the nuclear norm such that x is equal to xc. And we were able to demonstrate that the solution can be computed in closed form. And in fact, it can be computed in closed form directly from the SVD of the data. And then we have a theorem that says that if the subspaces are independent, then the entry ij of the matrix, namely whether xi can be expressed as a linear combination of xj and that coefficient is zero or not, we show that the coefficient is zero when points xi and xj are in different subspaces. What that means effectively is that you make no incorrect connections. You never connect a point I and a point J that are in different subspaces. Okay? So, what are the great things of this method? What are the big pluses? The first one is that we do not, no need to know the dimensions of the subspace. No. Right? It's not in the problem formulation, it's nowhere. Regardless of what the dimensions are, these theorems are true. Except for course, and this I'm going to put immediately as the minus, right? We require independence. So the sum of the dimensions of the subspaces needs to be equal to the dimension of the sum. That was the basic assumption of independence. So yeah, I don't need to know what the dimensions are. Big, big, big plus. But I do have some constraints on what the dimensions can be. The next thing is or the next minus might be that this only applies to the noiseless noiseless data. That being said, you know, all other methods we discussed before, we had no theorems of any kind. So in a sense, having some theorems for noisy data is a plus. So the theorems. So theoretical analysis. Another plus, I think, is that it's in fact a closed form solution. It's very interesting that even though the problem is data with a union of subspaces, by doing effectively PCA, we get an affinity matrix for multiple subspaces. So that's not that bad. Okay. So the natural questions to ask next are, I think, two. One is, what happens if the data is noisy? What could go wrong? And in some cases, the performance or the theorems might degrade slowly with mistakes. And spectral clustering, I think, was a great example, right? The fact that the dimension of the null space of the Laplacian is exactly equal to the number of connected components was true in the, not noiseless case, but rather the case where the graph exactly has n connected components. But when we went and perturbed the Laplacian by adding a few wrong connections, the low dimensional embedding based on the eigenvectors still preserved the clustering of the data, in a sense, right? So small perturbations of the Laplacian didn't have a catastrophic effect. So we might ask here, what happens if the data has a little bit of noise? What's going to happen? So what we might expect is that these numbers are exactly equal to zero and now become small. Okay? And that would be fine. And in fact, that would be entirely analogous to what happened in the case of spectral clustering, which is that having a few numbers that are small, it's like having a few wrong connections that are very weak, and therefore the algorithm will be robust to that. So is that the case? Is that what happens? So if we don't modify the algorithm in any way, the issue is that this constraint of expressing a point exactly as a linear combination of others, this may no longer be true, right? But if I forget about the original optimization problem and I just go by the optimal solution, right? In fact, I don't need the optimization problem anymore because all what this says is take the data, do a compact SVD according to its rank, and then get the V1, V1 transpose. So now if the data is noisy and I just follow this procedure blindly, the key thing is gonna be what is the rank that I need to pick. And obviously, when there is noise, we're going to go from the exact rank of the data matrix, perhaps to it being full rank. If we go from the rank of the data matrix to being full rank, and so we're doing this blindly, then the V matrix, instead of being, you know, the V1 transpose, which is supposed to be like this, right? This is R and this is N, right? Let's go to the extreme case. It's going to be now a rotation matrix, or actually, strictly speaking, it's just an orthogonal matrix, right? Let's say it's going to be an n by n, right? I pick r equals to n because it's noisy. Then what's going to happen with vv transpose? Actually, it's going to become the identity, right? Because it's orthogonal. So in that particular case, v transpose v is the identity, but also vv transpose is the identity. The matrix V becomes square. Okay. So that's going to be a very bad affinity because it only connects each point to itself. So sure, it will make no wrong connections, but that's because it doesn't connect to anyone else, right? Okay? So I went to extreme cases, but to show that in fact this property might actually be preserved. But it's not the whole story. Right. There is also the question of, do I get a good affinity, and that is it well connected or not? So, if data is noisy, then V1, which is typically we wanted it to be like this, right? V1 is n by r. R is equal to the rank of X, may be the rank and so V1 transpose when we get it. So this, in fact, suggests that I need to do some modification, and I need to have a way of controlling the rank. I cannot tolerate the rank to be arbitrary. So what people did for a while, in fact, was just truncate the rank to a few. But then you would observe that how do the affinities look like? So in theory, we want the affinities to look like this. That was the ideal affinity in the noiseless case. But this is with R equals to the true rank. I might get something like that. But what happens is that if you select R that is bigger than the true rank, then you might actually completely lose this log diagonal structure. And if you choose R that is maybe smaller, then you tend to still in general for certain. So that's a thing sort of a practical observation. But the key issue then is what I'm trying to convey in the noisy situation is that it's the model selection thing with PCA. How many eigenvectors should I choose? And we learned from PCA that if we want to do that from an optimization perspective, I cannot do it just by having that original problem. Because if I do it, then I'm going to end up in this situation where things will rank and I'm going to have a bad affinity. But I need to have some way of penalizing the rank. Okay. So that's what motivates this second sort of low rank subspace clustering with noise. And so what can be done with noise is. That formulation, I don't know where I put the tab. Okay. So what we're going to do is minimize the nuclear norm of C plus tau of Q X minus X. So what this says effectively is really, what is this second term? This second term is really the LLE plus term, right? It's really express a point as a linear combination of other data points and minimize the reconstruction error. So if I didn't have the first term, that's exactly the LLE cost, with the key difference being that in LLE, you constrain the C's to be non-zero only for the nearest neighbor. Here we are allowing reconstruction from anyone. So this is effectively a reconstruction error. So if this was PCA, right, this would have been the data minus the basis times the coefficients. Is effectively, from the PCA perspective, it's like choosing a basis which is just the data itself. So this is not a basis, strictly speaking, but rather it's sort of a dictionary. For those of you who've taken the sparse representation class, this is a redundant dictionary. And now, among all possible approximate reconstructions, we're going to select that where the coefficients are low rank. So now that I've made this modification, the question is, well, does this change the optimization problem? And it really looks like a model selection problem in PCA, right? Because in PCA, what we have? In PCA, we had the data minus the basis times the coefficient squared plus lambda times the nuclear norm of what did we have? Well, actually, what it was is, given a matrix A, find another matrix that is close to it, and ensure that that other matrix is low rank. So it's on the same style as that model selection that we did for PCA, with the difference being that instead of searching for a matrix that is close to X, right, we are searching for an approximation of the data as linear combinations of itself. So this is what we would call a self-expressive representation, with low rank coefficients. And the reason is that we're not doing PCA. We're trying to find this affinity matrix that really captures the multi-subspace term. So, the result is that the optimal solution, so this is a theorem, or theorem 8.10. So the optimal solution, C star, is given by E times P of 1 over square root of sigma or lambda times V transpose, where E of 1 over square root tau lambda is equal to the identity. Here, what we have is that x equals to u lambda v transpose is the SVD of x. And lambda 1 is eigenvalues. How the optimal solution is computed. So step number one is that we just compute the SVD of the data. Step number two is that we are going to select the subset of singular values that are above some threshold, and that threshold is 1 over square root of tau. But we don't do the traditional shrinkage thresholding as we used to do. So in the traditional case, what we would have done is to keep the singular values as they were and subtract the threshold from it. What we do now is we take the identity matrix and we subtract 1 over tau, and we have this sort of polynomial and inverse polynomial transformation of the eigenvalue. So effectively, what we do is that we replace lambda is replaced by 1 minus 1 over tau lambda squared. That's what this operation does. Okay. So you see the difference? Before, in the past, what we would have done is just take lambda and replace it by lambda minus. If this was a threshold, that's what we would do, right? We would just shrink it by the threshold. Now we do a complete nonlinear transformation of it. Okay? Now, why do we need this special and linear strange transformation? So note that if tau goes to infinity, then C star is just V1 V1 tau. So if tau goes to infinity, right, this thing here, the diagonal, is the identity minus something. But that something, because tau is infinity, I just get the identity. Okay? So what I'm going to get here is V times the identity times V transpose. But still, we have to be very careful that this lambda 1 is the singular values that are above 1 over square root of tau. If tau goes to infinity, being above 1 square root of tau is being non-negative.
So it really just keeps the eigenvalues that are non-zero. So effectively what it does is that it takes the full SVD, it keeps only the non-negative, the non-zero singular values. So effectively just keeps the V1 part, because it keeps the part that corresponds to the non-zero eigenvalue. And then that's why it becomes V1, V1 transpose. Okay. Another way to see it is that this is V1, V2, right? Remember always. And now we've got the identity 0, 0, 0, and then V1, V2 transpose. In fact, maybe that's the way I should have written this thing here, right? That the C star really is V1, V2. And now I've got here, maybe that's the way I should have written it. I minus 1 over tau, lambda 1 minus 2, and then 0, 0, 0. And then V1, V2 transpose. So all I'm saying is that these are the ones that are above 1 over square root of tau. And these are the ones that go here. All right? So let me maybe repeat what this expression meant. What this expression meant was, take a V matrix of the SVD, split it into two parts. The top part is all of the ones that correspond to singular values above 1 over square root of tau. And the bottom one is the remaining one. And now, replace the lambda, you know, this would have been lambda 1 and lambda 2. When I took the SVD, maybe I should write that here. Okay, I'm going to write x is equal to u1, u2, sigma 1, sigma 2. Or in this particular case, I think it's lambda 1, lambda 2. And then v1, v2, transpose. Maybe this is the best notation. That's the original SVD of x. Okay? So I'm going to keep V1 and V2. I'm going to keep V1 and V2. This is transpose now. And I'm going to replace lambda 1 by identity minus that. And I'm going to replace the second part by z. That's what this equation is. And now, I hope you can see more vividly that if tau goes to infinity, right, first of all, this piece becomes the identity. And I just get V1, V1 transpose. But, in addition, in V1, instead of being those corresponding to singular vectors that are just above 1 over square root of tau, they become those that are above 0. And that's why it's equivalent to doing it out of the compact SVD. Is that clear? Okay, so going back to what we're really trying to do, good news. I can take the original problem, have a model selection version of it that accommodates noise, and the solution is still closed form, and it's still closed form from the SVD of the data. So in fact, this formula is just a weird or slightly more complex model selection style formula. That is, in fact, I call this polynomial thresholding, because instead of doing shrinkage thresholding, you do this nonlinear transformation of a singular vector. But what you might ask is, all right, can I replicate the theoretical results that we had, which was that there's no wrong connection when two points are in different subspaces in this noisy setting? And unfortunately, the answer is, I was going to say no, but the answer is really, I don't know. There's been no paper that has demonstrated even that in the case of independent subspaces with noisy data, you would have the fact that Cij is zero when points I and j are in different subspaces. So, theory for noisy Lorentz subspace clustering is inexistent. Okay, so what I'm going to move next is, the theory is inexistent, but that doesn't mean that it doesn't work well. And so in fact, I'm going to be showing the applications and examples on Friday that there are lots of applications of it, and that in many practical settings it performs very well. But I just want to sort of keep in mind the advantages and disadvantages. It requires the subspaces to be independent, and that could be a strong condition. It can be formulated in the noisy setting, and you can have a closed form solution, but then there is no theorem for correctness. So the only case that is well studied and well understood is this noiseless. So what we're going to do next is to exploit the possibility that I mentioned at the beginning is this the only way by which I can regularize the matrix of coefficients? Being low rank was one particular case. In fact, maybe I should remind you of another weakness, and I should have written this here in the minuses there, is that it requires the data to be low rank. Okay. So a weakness. X may not be. So, example, suppose that I give you 20 subspaces, the dimension is 5, and the ambient dimension is 100, right? If they're independent, this means that the rank of X will be equal to 100, which is equal to D, okay? Because you have 5 subspaces, each one of dimension 20, they're independent, so the dimension of the sum will be equal to the sum of the dimensions, so that'll be 5 times 20, that's 100. That's the same as the ambient dimension. So each subspace is of small dimension, very small, but the sum of them is of high dimension. And the key starting point of everything was that we had this x equal to xc, and we took the rank of these is equal to the rank of that, right? And we said that this is less than or equal to the rank of c, right? And the reason for minimizing the rank was because the smallest possible rank be achieved to be equal to the rank of the data. And that's how we got a solution different from the identity, because the identity would be full rank. Okay? So it was very important that the data be of low rank in order to get a good affinity. So in general, this need not be the case, and here's a concrete example where this is not. Okay. So what we're going to be covering now is this other method called sparse subspace clustering that doesn't care about So let's revisit the basic and fundamental equation. So we're going to take the data point, and we're going to express it as a linear combination of other data points. And that's what this matrix X is equal to XC represents. So instead of searching for a low rank representation, what if we search for a sparse one? So, sparse subspace. So the idea is I'm going to minimize the L0 norm of the coefficients such that xj is equal to x times cj. That's it. Express data point xj as a linear combination of all other data points and search for a solution that is as sparse as possible. So let's look at this picture here. So what this picture really tells us is the following. Suppose that I take that green point that is right there. I'm going to express it, and this picture is really meant to represent here a union of three lines. Suppose that you pick that green point and you express it as a linear combination of all other data points. Okay.
Again, as we've said repeatedly, the solution may not be unique. There are lots of ways in which this point can be reached from the combination of everybody else. But if I ask you for a sparse solution, what is the sparsest you can possibly achieve? First of all, I hope to convince you that every green point, because it's in the plane, it can be written as a linear combination of just any two points in the plane. So in particular, I could pick, you know, one red and one blue and so on and so forth. So in fact, when I ask you for the sparsest, you already know that it's at most two. Okay. So the key question here in this picture is simply, can you do better than two? And if you can do better than two, the only better than two is one. So could you write a point as a linear combination of one other data point? And sparsity ones means that they must be scalar multiples of each other. And so in this case, clearly, every green point is a scalar multiple of any other green point. So the answer is yes, you can always write a point as a linear combination of other points in the sparsest possible way. And in this particular case, you can do it with one non-zero coefficient. So this one. But the interesting thing is that if you search for the sparsest, is the solution unique?
No.
Because every green point, and I'm taking the one on the right again, is a multiple of any one of the other green points. Okay. So if I ask the question, express the green point and a linear combination of others, search for the sparsest, there's still lots of possible solutions. But the interesting observation is that all such solutions have the following property. First, the number of non-zero coefficients is equal to the dimension of the subspace to which that point belongs. In this particular case, one. It's always one non-zero coefficient. Second, the non-zero coefficients will correspond to other points in the same subspace because the non-zero coefficients always come from green points. In fact, you could not do that with a red point, right? Because this green point on the right is not a scalar multiple of that of any of the red points, or any of the blue points, for that matter. Okay. So this picture suggests that the number of non-zero coefficients is equal to the dimension of the subspace. And this suggests also that the non-zero coefficients correspond to points in the same subspace. So I just want to pause for a moment. If this fact that I've just tried to convince you was true, we would be done. Because we would be able to automatically discover what is the dimension of the subspace. And we would be able to actually figure out, connect that point to other points in the same group. So let's see if this intuition carries over to other pictures. So in this case, now I've moved to a three-dimensional plane, and I have a plane and two lines. Okay. And let's repeat the same exercise. Everything is in R3, right? So I'm going to take any of the green points, and I'm going to ask the same question. Can I take a green point, which is a point in R3, and express it as a linear combination of all greens and blues and reds? Okay. The answer should be yes, I can always do that. And in fact, I hope you're convinced at this point that I just need three points in R3 to express any point in R3 for that matter, right? So as soon as I have three linearly independent points, I can express that green point. So now I'm going to ask for a sparser solution, or the sparsest possible. Okay, so can I do it with less than three is the question. So because that green point is in that green plane, any point in that green plane can be expressed as a linear combination of two points in that same plane. So that green point can be expressed as any, you know, pick any two points in that plane and that are linearly independent, and that would be enough. So when I ask what is the sparsest, right? In this particular case, it would be with two non-zero coefficients. And those two non-zero coefficients should come from the same. So the same principle looks like it's true, that the number of non-zero coefficients will give you the dimension of the subspace, and the non-zero coefficients will correspond to points in the same subspace. And what's going to change now is, because different subspaces have different dimensions, if I do that exercise for a red point, I'm going to get even a sparser solution. I should get it with one non-zero coefficient, because that red point is a scalar multiple of any other red point, as we argued before. Okay? So if we do this exercise of expressing one point as a linear combination of the others and searching for a sparse solution, what should happen is that every red point will have a sparsity level of 1 and will connect itself only to red points. Similarly for blue points. And green points would have a sparsity level of 2 and would connect only to other green points. That's what we seem to be expecting. Except that that's not always true. So I've just fooled you around, because you could pick, you know, pick this green point right here. So that could have been expressed maybe as halfway between that guy and that guy. So there could be a coincidental situation where a green point is a linear combination of a blue and a red. And in that case, the sparsity level is still 2. But now, I pick point from different groups. Okay. So it is important to now go to the next theoretical level, which is, what are the conditions under which it is guaranteed? So in a sense, I know the existence question. I know that there exist sparse solutions to the problem that have the property of connecting points, of not connecting points across subspaces. I know that that existential question is true. But the question is, how do I find the sparse solutions that have the property that I want? Because there are many sparse solutions. And I, among all of them, I want those that have the property of not connecting points across different groups. So that's exactly the questions. Under what conditions the solution to this sparse problem would preserve the clustering of the data? So you would say, aha, well, first of all, how do I compute it? That's one question. I need to really find sparsest solutions. And the other one is, what are the conditions under which this works? So when it comes to how to compute it, we could simply say, well, we learned earlier in the class that I can take the L0 minimization problem and replace it by an L1 minimization. And the L0 minimization is intractable, because how do I find the sparses? Well, I just need to take all possible combinations. And in fact, because we don't know the sparsity level here, it's even harder, right? In the picture that I was showing before, what would I do? I would try sparsity level 1. I would try sparsity level 2. Eventually, I would get a solution. But it's combinatorial, because I need to go through over all possible choices of k points. But in addition, I don't know k. So instead, let's do L1. And if I do L1, I get a convex problem. And I have ways in which I can potentially solve that convex problem. And so the real question is, well, when are these problems equivalent? And there are all of these results from sparse representation theory telling you that under some conditions on X, particularly being incoherent is one such condition. And if you remember the first part of the class, what did it mean, incoherence? Well, we actually had lots of definitions of incoherence, right? Because it was always incoherence with respect to something. We had incoherence of a matrix with respect to the set of sparse matrices. That was something that we used a lot in matrix completion. This was this notion of incoherence was for the purpose of solving the linear system of equations and finding the sparsest solution of it. And in that particular case, incoherence simply meant that if I take two columns of that matrix, the angle between those two columns is above some threshold.
So we have this nice theorem that says that if x is incoherent, then the solutions to the L0 and the L1 are the same. And in fact, the theorems were of the kind, of the following kind. I have a C that is k sparse. I use it to generate x. Now I give you x, I give you a capital X, and I want you to find exactly that k sparse vector that you started. That was what these theorems are able to guarantee. Does this apply to our setting? You could say, okay, we are absolutely done. All we're going to do is just apply these results to a case. What is our case? Our case is a case where X is the data matrix, and that comes from a union of subspaces. And we're going to be able to recover exactly that unique sparse vector. Does it make sense? Is there anything that I'm saying that doesn't make sense in applying this to our set? Is this really a sparse, is what we need to do really a sparse recovery in the traditional sense? So just to illustrate this, what we really want to, what we really want is something like the following, and I'm illustrating this with our classical example of faces. I'm expressing a face as a linear combination of all faces coming from different individuals, and I'm looking for a set of coefficients. And I would like the coefficients, the non-zero entries, to come from the faces of the same individual, and I would like the coefficients corresponding to all other individuals to be zero. That's what we're trying to do. And that's how I'm going to figure out that this face from individual one should be connected to face number one and face number, whatever, six from that same individual. And there should be no connection to faces from any other individual. But is this a sparse recovery problem? And the answer is that it's not really. Why? Let me begin with the bottom. Here. In classical sparse recovery, there is an inherent assumption that there is a unique sparse solution I'm trying to compute. Okay. Namely, if I go back to my equations here, the idea is that given X, there is a unique C that is K sparse. And that's what these theorems from Donohoe, Canvas, and Trop, and others guarantee that you're going to be able to find that unique C that is K sparse that generated the data X. In our problem, because the dictionary is not arbitrary but sort of a special dictionary, what kind of dictionary we have? It's data from a union of subspaces. I already went through a lot of explanations to try to convince you that given a green point, I can express it as a linear combination of any two green points in the same group. So the sparse solutions are never unique, because any two points in the same subspace would do the job. Okay. So I can. So that's the first point. The theorems from classical sparse recovery do not apply to this, even though it's the same optimization problem. Okay. There is an important difference, which is that we are not after unique solutions. And in fact, we're just trying to connect points to other points in the same group. Okay. And so as long as our connections are correct, we are happy. But we don't care exactly about finding one particular and unique set of coefficients. Any two points in the same group are equally good from the perspective of clustering. So that's the first observation, and that's what's written here, that the sparse solutions are not unique. The second one is whether you can guarantee this property of incoherence or not. And the property of incoherence really says that if I take the dot product between pairs of data points, those dot products will be above some, below some threshold. Or equivalently, the angle between pairs of points is above some threshold.
So this need not be the case in principle, right? It depends on how I sample the data inside subspaces, right? But I could get pairs of points to be close. In fact, I could have repeated sampling in the case of a union of subspaces. This idea of having the points sufficiently separated is critical to get these unique solutions. In fact, the fact that they're close to each other is what prevents the unique sparse solutions to exist, because eventually I could replace one atom by the other atom. In subspace clustering, you know, we're just given samples from the subspace. So in principle, unless I make that as an extra assumption, which I could. So with that in mind, we need new theorems. I think that was the main point. We need new theorems. The classical theorems on sparsity don't apply. And so here's the first theorem. The first theorem is, if the subspaces are independent, which is the same assumption that we have for Laurent subspace clustering, then the matrix of solution C will be subspace preserved. Namely, the non-zero coefficients will come only from other points in the same. And that's what we're going to prove now. Okay. So theorem. Is if subspaces are independent, then Cij is 0 when Xi same theorem as before, with a dramatically key difference, which is that in the Laurent case, we had a closed form solution for what the matrix looks like, right? So we could analyze what that matrix looks like. Here, we have this L1 minimization problem for which we do not have a closed form solution. And so, we need to do the analysis and the proofs without having access to the closed form. So suppose that, I'm going to do the following. Suppose that I take a point x. I'm going to do it for a generic point, in fact. Let me see. So let x belong to some subspace. Suppose that I take the data matrix and I'm going to partition it into two parts, the data from the correct subspace and the data from all other subspaces. And that's going to be my notation. Data from the L subspace and data from all other subspaces. So I'm going to take the data point x, I'm going to write it as a linear combination of the data points. And as a consequence, I'm going to split the x now into xl, x minus l, and by analogy, I'm going to have cl and c minus l. So I'm going to split the vector of coefficients into coefficients that correspond to points in the same subspace and coefficients that correspond to points in other subspaces. So in fact, maybe this picture is really good as to what I'm trying to do here. This picture. It's exactly this picture, right? I'm going to split the data into red versus blue and green. And the coefficients CL are going to be all of the red coefficients. And the coefficients C minus L are going to be all of the blue and the green. So what I want to do is want to prove that CL is non-zero and C minus L is zero, right? I want to prove that the coefficients corresponding to other groups are all zero.
and the coefficients corresponding to my own groups are not zero. From this equation, what I can immediately write is that x minus xl c minus l is equal to x minus l c sub minus l, right? That's the same equation. Because I hope you see from here, right, that I can expand this as xl cl plus x minus l c minus l, right? Can expand that. So what I'm going to do then is just move this to the left hand side, and that's what I get. So now, this point XL, so this point X, which subspace does it belong to? What subspace does this belong to? SL. So this guy belongs to SL. Now, what about this point? What is XL again? It's the set of all points that are in subspace L. Once I multiply by any vector, what would happen? This is just taking linear combinations of the columns of XL. So as a consequence, what subspace does this belong to? Also SL, right? This must belong to SL. And now if I take the difference of two points in SL, what happens? It must also be in SL. So the left-hand side is a point in the L subspace. What about the right-hand side? This right-hand side, you know, what is X minus L? It's a set of all data points from all other groups, okay? So what I'm going to be doing now is taking linear combinations of points from all other subspaces. So this is really a point that belongs to the sum of subspaces where J is not equal to L, right? It belongs to the sum of all other subspaces, right? Agreed? And you remember now what the definition of sum of subspaces was, right? I already taught you that, and I illustrated. What is the sum of two lines in R2? Or more generally, in a big ambient dimensional space, what is the sum of two lines? It's the plane spanned by the two lines, right? Remember that? Okay? Effectively, the sum of subspaces is any point that can be written as the sum of one point from each subspace. All right, so is the sum of a subspace of subspaces a subspace? Right? Yes?
Yes.
Okay. So, I have a point on the left, I have a point in SL. On the right, I have a point in the sum of all other subspaces other than SL. So as a consequence, if this point is in one subspace and this point is in another subspace, then it must be in the intersection. So as a consequence, this means that X belongs to the intersection between SL and the sum of SJ, J not equal to L. Okay? So the point belongs to both. So, now it's where the independence assumption comes in. So if the subspaces are independent, what is the intersection between one subspace and this sum of the other subspace? Okay, let's go back to the simple thing here. These are independent lines because 1 plus 1 is equal to 2, right? What is the intersection of those two lines? The zero vector. Okay. More broadly, right, again, think about the classical example that I gave, right? It's like I've got a matrix. So
so many columns on subspace 1, so many columns on subspace 2, and so on and so forth, right? What did we say about independence? That this, the rank of X was equal to the sum of the ranks of the X-axis. That was the essential definition of independence. The dimension of the sum is equal to the sum of the dimensions, okay? So all I'm saying now is that I've got a point in the first subspace and a point in the sum of all the others, okay? So now I've got a point in the intersection, okay? So how is that going to happen if the dimension of the sum is equal to the sum of the dimensions, right? There cannot be anything on the intersection, because if there was something on the intersection, the dimension of the sum would not be equal to the sum of the dimensions. I would get a dimension of the sum that is a little bit smaller, right? So all that what I'm trying to convince you is that independence implies, in this case, that there can be no intersection between one subspace and any sum of the other subspaces, except for the trivial intersection, which is the origin, because the origin always belongs to any subspace. So as a consequence, since the SIs are independent, what we have is that X minus XL CL must be 0, and X minus L C minus L must be 0. Alright, well, but that's not what I want to prove, right? I want to prove that C is 0. I'm not there yet. I proved that X times C is 0. So in other words, I proved that the contribution, effectively what this is doing here is that the data point X is being divided into two parts. One is the contribution from its own subspace, and another one is the contribution from other subspaces. What I've proven is that independence guarantees that the contribution from other subspaces is 0. But I want to go farther. I want to show that not only the contribution is 0, but that contribution is obtained using 0 coefficients, which is, of course, a particular case. But I'm just solving the optimization problem, so I don't know if what I will obtain will be with C equal to 0. That's what I want to prove. Okay? So I'm just one step farther. I took the data, I can reconstruct it from points in its own group plus points in other groups. I show that the contribution from other groups is 0. But I still need to show that the coefficients are 0. Right. So the next thing is, well, I need to remind myself what the optimization problem is, and the optimization problem is what's going to say. I'm trying to minimize the L1 norm, for example. I'm trying to minimize the L1 norm of C, or for that matter, any norm. So in fact, I'm going to put an arbitrary norm, because it's true for any norm. I'm going to try to minimize that, and because of what the partition that I've done, this is the same as the norm of CL and C minus L. Okay? It's a vector. Okay? And let's do the following. So let how am I going to do this? Okay. So that's what I'm trying to do. Of course, this is such that x is equal to 2x over times. So let C star be the optimal solution. Suppose that I express a point as a linear combination of all others. Suppose that I found the global optimum and that C star, and I'm going to try to make a contradiction,
right?
So for the sake of contradiction, assume that C minus L star was different. I need to prove that that guy is zero, and so to make a contradiction, I'm going to assume that it's different. Now, define or let C hat be CL star and zero. So I'm going to define a different solution obtained by the optimal coefficient with respect to the correct subspace, and I'm going to set to zero all others. So because this guy C star is the optimum, right, this C hat shouldn't have an objective value that is below that of C star. But let's compute it. So then, what I can see here is that the L1 norm of C, or LQ norm of C, is going to be the norm of this vector. But because this guy has a zero here, this has to be less than the Q norm of CL star and C minus L star, right? Think of, in fact, the L1 norm for the sake of argument. What is the L1 norm? It's the sum of the absolute values of the entries. So I'm going to take the sum of the absolute values of these parts and then zeros, versus sum of the absolute values of the same part plus the sum of the absolute values of this. But because I made the assumption that that is a non-zero vector, I need to have something extra, right? So this has to be strictly bigger than that. That's also true with any of the L2 norm, right? This is the sum, it's going to be the sum of the square of the entries, right? It's going to be the same, sum of square of the entries for the first part. But then I'm going to have a zero, and here I'm going to have a non-zero because of that assumption. But that is the objective function that I was minimizing, right? So what I've demonstrated is that the objective function, actually two things I need to demonstrate, right? I need to demonstrate that that this x hat, c hat is a feasible solution. So let's see if c hat is a feasible solution, right? So x times c hat is x minus l, x minus l times c l star and zero. So this is equal to s l c l star, right? But because of the equation that I have at the top, right? Look at the equation that I have right there. This must be equal to x, right? Right? So in other words, c hat is a feasible solution and the c hat q is less than C star. So I have found a feasible solution whose objective value is lower than that of the global norm. And so that's where I get a contribution. So as a consequence, it cannot be the case that C minus that's that. So as a consequence, therefore, C minus L star. Then thereby proving that the coefficients corresponding to other groups are also So in summary, what have we done so far? We have explored two ways of building affinities. One is with low rank priors, and the other one is with sparse priors. We've shown that in the noiseless case, in independent subspaces, both of them give what I've called subspace preserving solutions, namely coefficients corresponding to other groups are zero. Therefore, very good affinities. You would say, well, which method should I prefer? I guess the low rank one, right? It's usually closed form. I don't need to solve any optimization problem. Why should I use instead of one method? Okay. So in the next lecture, what I'm going to demonstrate is that the low rank method, as I've already said, with noise, there is no theory. But for this sparse method, there is theory for noisy cases. There is theory for corrupted entries. There is theory for outliers.